the rock star, the man, the husband and father, in conversation with Johathan Ross and his laptop.
Meat, let's have the answer.
Sorry, mate, what's the question?
I don't know, I can't remember now. Hello, I'm Johathan Ross, and I'm just about to interview the near-legendary rock and roll performer, Meat Loaf. Now, the worry I have about interviewing Meat Loaf is that I know he's in the middle of a world tour, and he's doing interviews just about every day. And I know for a fact that Meat Loaf is one of those rock and roll types who goes completely mad if he's asked a question that he considers silly or unnecessary or just plain dumb. But there are certain things you just have to talk about, like, for example, his name. I mean, let's face it, Meat Loaf is a really silly name.
Don't ask me silly questions. I'll give you really silly answers.
I love the silly answers. That's what I
love. Okay, go ahead.
And if you get past the sticky name problem, then you come to the question, of course, of his weight. And let's face it, for a certain time, Meat Loaf was the only big fat rock star we had.
But anyway, I'm saying I don't think the size has anything to do with it.
But if you've managed to get through the name and the weight questions, then of course you have to ask him about the latest album, which is the brilliantly titled Bat Out of Hell 2. The follow-up to Bat Out of Hell 1, which was all of 16 years ago.
I didn't know it was that long. You're
the
first person to tell me
that. You've got to pay more attention to your career, because
wow,
that was a
man,
big gap.
16 years?
Well, your guess is as good as mine as to how he'll react to my probing questions, but I think I can rely on my intelligence, my presence, and my British charm to get through the interview without the slightest hint of a rock and roll tantrum.
You little moron.
Now then, Meat Loaf. Mr. Loaf, Meat, Mr. Loaf, what would you prefer?
Meat's fine. How you doing, Johathan?
Nice to meet you, sir.
Do you always do interviews with your power book?
Only when I'm trying to impress.
Ah.
Meat, you're sitting down with me. How many weeks into this tour for the huge, phenomenal success of Bat Out of Hell 2, Back Into Hell?
Oh, I don't, just short. Not, I don't know how many weeks.
And they're all evenings, no matinees?
That was a good question. No matinees.
So you've done what, 50? So let's break that
down.
Well,
I do a Saturday afternoon kids matinee, though, Johathan. Well, it's like, I do that, yeah. I dress up like a duck, a big yellow one. Sometimes, though, I go as a purple duck. Well, duck and the sword, where the duck puts the sword in the stone. And then, it's kind of interesting.
You thought it through. You're calling the kiddie market.
Yeah.
So I suppose you're about 10 weeks into this.
Don't ask me silly questions. I'll give you really silly answers.
I like the silly answers. That's what
okay,
I look
go
for.
Ahead.
But you've done, 10 weeks or something like that?
Somewhere along
And
that.
You've been doing interviews all over the place, I would imagine.
I have done a couple of interviews.
So you must be tired.
Very astute of you to know that.
Well, a lot of the questions you've been asked, I'm sure you get tired of. So I thought I'd start by saying
I'll stop you right there. I never get tired of the questions. Because most people only get to ask me one question, and then I just answer them. I just go.
As I've just noticed.
Free form thinking, free association.
Kind of like a Jimi Hendrix approach to thinking.
To guitar, yes, yeah. That's right.
Similar thing. But let me ask you, though, is there something that you would like to talk about to just get off your chest that you haven't been consulted about? I mean, be it sex
your
or
tailor?
Sport or my tailor? You like the cut of my gear?
I like that, yeah.
And what about the suit?
I like your suit, yeah.
So back onto Back Into Hell.
Okay. Bat Out of Hell 2.
16 years between Bat Out of Hell 1 and Bat
no,
Out of Hell
go
2.
Ahead.
Yeah. And I bet it just
no,
flew.
You're kidding.
I bet it just flew by.
Really,
right
that long? Nobody's told me that yet.
But
I haven't heard that one yet. I didn't know it was that long.
You're
the first person to tell me
you've
that.
You've got to pay more attention to your career, because
wow,
that was a
man,
big gap.
16 years. Nobody else has mentioned that. Nobody else has mentioned how old I am or how much I weigh either. It's
hey,
funny.
Hey, hey, give me a chance to get to those topics in a minute, because I can see you're burning.
Let's see, 16 years, 17 stone, and 45, 42, 38, 46, 48 in Q.
The weight needn't be an issue unless you make it one.
Oh, no, but I think they should do it to everybody. I think what? Billy Idol, 33, 11 stone. I mean, why just me?
I haven't done it to you. You're giving me a hard time.
I'm not doing it to you. I'm just people who see this. I'm giving them a hard time.
Let it out now. Get it all out your system
now.
We are.
It's out. It's gone. Right. It's out. Okay. It's like, can I lay down while we do this?
So 16 years, 17 stone.
And, 40. and I'm so confused. I've read how old I am so many times, I don't even know how old I am anymore. 42, thank you.
42, well, it makes no difference to me. I think you're a very attractive man regardless of the
Well, I'm not going out with you, so don't even start with that. I mean, I'll go to dinner, but we won't sit close like they do in the movies, you know, like in Hollywood. Remember the old, what, the Brown Derby? And you used to sit close and go, hey, baby, you know, go ahead.
I'm barely paying attention. I don't know what the hell you're talking about there.
Yeah, it's all this stuff is not written
it's
in the PowerPoint.
It's got nothing to do with my questions.
I got news for you. Go ahead.
All right, so now you had the first huge success. Then there were years of albums which did well, but they were nowhere near as phenomenally successful as the first. Then you're back with this one, and it's like, why did it take you so long? I know you've been asked this. I know, and
but I
it's
have.
Not, you know, but
no, why?
Was it the problem? Was it the collaborative problem you had with Mr. Steinman, or was it just?
No, I don't look as. It doesn't feel that long. I'm really being honest. There was a very long period of time between 79 and 84, and then since 84, the middle of 84, everything has progressed the way it should have to me. We came with an album called Bad Attitude, then I came with another record, then I did a live thing, and then I asked the record company I was on, well, first in 86, I asked the record company I was on, look, Jim Steinman and I want to do another record, and they looked at me and said, well, we're not interested.
Now you say, now that's a very stupid thing to ever say.
Well, I agree with you wholeheartedly. I walked in, I was really excited. I haven't told anybody this story, so I'll tell you. I was really excited. I flew all the way from the States into London, because that's where everybody was, and I went in, and I got an appointment, and I did the whole thing. I didn't ask them, you know, the record company didn't pay for it. I did it all. I said, okay, cool. So I go in there, all sitting there, and I go in and I go, all right, I got great news. This is fantastic. This is really great. I've met with Jim Steinman. We've had several meetings. We've been out to his house. I've been singing with him. He's writing a new song, and we want to do another record together. And they didn't even hesitate. I mean, it was like they knew I was going to say this. And they just looked at me and they said, well, that's very interesting, but we really are not interested in anything like that. And I kind of like, excuse me? And they went, no, we're not interested. First, 1 week, think it'll cost too much money. And Jim Steinman is very difficult to deal with. And so... So we, I think somebody did tell him I was coming. I don't know who.
With the story.
Yeah, but, and they said he's very difficult to deal with, and we really were not interested in doing it right. And I said, and I just sit there for a minute, and I said, well, you know what? That's fine, and I really appreciate your time and everything, and I'm not interested in being on this label anymore.
Now, listen, good video for the hit single.
It is
well.
A good video.
It's a good video.
And as a director's... Largely
well,
responsible.
I'm not
for
even
it.
Remotely interested in the director, I'll be honest with you.
Well, that's okay, but I'm going to tell you his name is Michael Bay.
Good man. Foxy Babe in the video, yet again.
Oh, you're interested in Dana Patrick.
I'll be fully frank with you, as only a man can with another man. But you're a happily married man here, you've got kids, and these gorgeous women in your videos.
I'm a sex guy.
Ever tempted?
No. But I'm a sex guy. You know that, right?
We all know that.
I know that. I mean, jeez, come on.
You're safe in that knowledge.
That's right. I am safe in that knowledge.
Now, you have two daughters.
It was on the front of the Daily Mirror Sunday magazine. I'm a sex guy.
What official.
That's right. Yeah. It's in print. It must be true.
When they make your sex card, do you get a card or a badge or something which proves it that you can carry around with you, like a donor card?
You don't need a card or a badge. You just are.
Can I just ask you about Meat Loaf, the family man?
Sure.
You don't mind? Because I'm curious, because you've got two daughters. One's 18, one's 12, 13?
12.
You were saying? And what kind of dad are you? Because you're here,
good.
You're doing a good display, quite loud, quite forceful.
Yeah.
At home.
I'm a
you're
good
a strict
dad.
Father?
Yeah, I am. I'm very conservative.
But I wondered, now, you, as you pointed out, you're a sex god. And you know full well, as we all do, what men are like with women. You know, they love them, they appreciate them, we cherish
yeah,
them. But
that's
also,
fine.
There's a physical thing.
Yeah, just don't look at my daughter.
Is that tough? Yeah, I wondered. When a daughter gets... Because I have a daughter, and I'm always scared about it.
I have a shotgun taped underneath the drum riser.
But I must admit, I would hate to be a young man of maybe 15, 16, First date, you go out and pick up the girl, the door opens, it's Meat Loaf standing there, and he goes, what the hell do you want?
Oh, no, my favorite story of that one is there was this fella that had this reputation, right? And my wife, the one thing that you can never do with kids is tell them don't do something. Well, that's the same way with me. See, because I have this rebellious nature, and my kids have it as well. So if you say, don't do that, that's going to be the first thing they do. Most people, that's what it is. It's like, no. So my wife was freaking out that she was going to go out with this boy. And she was refusing. I said, look, the more you tell her she can't go out with this boy, the more she's going to want to go out with this boy, and the longer we're going to have to deal with this
boy. That's true.
Because, first of all, you hope that we've raised them and that they're smart enough to see right through this human being. And so I said, let's let her go. And so she goes, okay, this is your call. You have to be home. I said, I'll be home. But I, this is funny. He was coming to pick her up, and I have a little front porch. And on the front porch, I have these white wicker chairs. And so at the time that he was coming to pick her up, I went out and I sat on the front porch. And he comes up in his Camaro or whatever he was driving, you know, screams up the thing. He gets out, and he starts walking up that thing, and I'm sitting there, and he sees me, and he kind of looks at me. And I said, oh, hi. I forgot his name now. I said, hi. He goes, hi. I said, you're going to take Pearl out, right? He goes, yeah. I said, okay. That's fine. I have no problem with that. She has a 12 o'clock curfew. You know that. Yeah. I said, okay, there's one other tiny little thing. The one thing that you better not do is you better not let anything happen to her. Because if anything happens to her, I'm going to hunt you down. I'm going to shoot you dead like a rabbit. I said, don't be drinking and driving and don't let anything happen to her because I love her. Yeah. So, and he goes, I scared the little daylights out of this
guy. I think that's the right way to behave. I think these are solid parenting tips we're giving out here.
Yeah, so, you know. And he brought her home at 11.
Yeah. And she was fitter and healthier than she'd ever been before in her life.
But now and then they went out again, and after two dates, she comes home and she says, that guy's a creep, you know. So.
Yeah, well, that's the way to do it. Let me go back to your music, if I may, because we've covered the parenting. I'm happy with that. I'm satisfied.
Okay.
Thank you for that.
As long as you're happy.
Why do so many of your songs, or your songs with Jim, why do they end in brackets? You have this... I'll do anything I love.
I have no idea yet.
But there's so many of them. They're just. It's always, you think, was it an afterthought? He added the extra bit?
No, he just, Jimmy just always has to, always have to say everything. I'm famous for saying everything three times. He's famous for saying everything four times. I mean, it's just the titles. He does cliches, and that's what it is. It's
remind me of some of the ones in brackets, because we've got, I'll do anything for love, but I won't do that.
Well, Paradise was the Paradise by the Dashboard Light, and then it's in three sections.
A lot of stuff after
praying
that.
For the end of time and all that stuff.
What's it gonna be, boy? Yes or no?
Let me sleep on it. Baby, baby, let me sleep on it. Well, let me sleep on it.
That stuff is so popular because it's just phenomenally popular.
Because I think the songs allow it really becomes theirs. It becomes their song. I no longer take part in that. If you could really peel and stick, you could take my name off and put, you know, the name of the guy who bought the record, because it's really what it is. And it really doesn't sit in any time. It has no place in the 70s. This has no place in the 90s. They both are based on true emotion. I think Bat Out of Hell 2 is more emotionally pure than Bat Out of Hell. And I think it's much more organic, and it's in the whole way we did it.
Now, there was you don't want to tell me specifically what you're thinking of when you're singing relating to certain songs, but overall, how do you work yourself into such a kind of operatic, seems the best word, but that kind of big, powerful, committed sound? There's a great quote.
The same way. I know what you're going to ask.
Let me give you this quote.
Okay, let him finish his question.
It said,
"Okay, now I'll let you finish. Go ahead."
Mr. Loaf sings. Mr. Loaf sings as if someone is holding his entire family ransom. And they will only be released if he delivers the goods.
Ooh, I like that. Oh, that's a
you
good
like that quote?
Yeah, I'll let you say that again.
No.
Yeah, come on.
No.
What was it? I'll say it then.
It's not written down. It's memory.
Okay, that was good, though. But I like that.
So
I
remember that quote.
My family's being held right.
And
I like
any
that
chance
quote.
Of you answering the question related
yeah,
to that?
Yeah, I'm just remembering that quote. That was a good one. Ooh, I like that.
Okay.
Who wrote that?
I can't remember.
Oh. Q Magazine?
You see, you knew all along, and you're just playing games with me.
No, I don't. No, because you said a while ago there was something from Q Magazine, and I'm saying that must be...
Meat. Let's have the answer.
So anyway, what's the question?
I don't know. I can't remember now. Don't ask me.
How do I do that?
Well, what are you thinking of? What are you doing?
The same way, I'll explain to you. You go, and it's and you. The best way to relate it, I think, for an average person would be, how do you think a marathon runner is able to run 26 miles? Besides, he's in great shape. The marathon runner, they are one with time, basically. They go into this zone. So what that does, what I do, and I do it on stage, I try to do it when you do film. You try to do it, it's like when I'm doing an interview with you, I don't think. I just let the free association. That's when the best interviews happen. When you just kind of zone it, and I call it going into a zone. And it's something that you don't learn. Just kind of happens to you. And when it happens to you, it's actually very scary.
Yeah, I mean, this sounds like a frightening experience to be in. I would have thought you could. Any chance of you going off into another song in the middle of this or something?
No, because you become one. You really.
So you're selling.
And I'm just saying that. I don't know how many performers actually know that place or are willing to give it, because you really have to give it up. You've given yourself over totally. It's sort of the extent of standing stark naked at noon on Oxford Street, you know?
I think it's probably a little easier to achieve than
yeah,
that.
Yeah. But I'm saying that's kind of a nice...
I know what you mean. It's a lot of giving. Yeah. Now, there's something I'd like to ask you. I've always thought, what were you like as a child? Because, obviously, you're quite physically intimidating, and you're larger than life in many respects. And were you... presumably, I've read that you
I was very quiet.
Yeah. Bookish?
I was bookish? Did you say bookish?
Yeah.
No, my mother wishes. No, I was just very quiet, and... was a jock in America, you know, an athlete, but still very quiet, very shy, hardly ever talked to anybody.
But which is hard to believe now when you see...
I know it's hard for me to believe it now, myself.
You know, you said you were a jock, and this is the thing. I've read two distinctly different stories as to how the Meat Loaf tag came about, one of which is quite obviously untrue.
Which one's that?
Well, let me do both of them.
Okay. Right?
One was that you trod on your football coach's foot, and he said, "Get off my foot, you Meat Loaf."
Mm-hmm.
The other one was that for a bet, you let a Volkswagen run over your head.
Yeah,
and
what about the pool?
Said,
the pool.
That's the only two I heard.
Oh, that's the only you didn't hear about the pool?
What's the pool story?
The pool? Well, the real story is the plane crash.
No, come on.
No, the real story
was
is
the one
the real
they,
story
they
is
landed
the,
that 747
no,
using
no,
just
no,
your
no,
head
no,
for the
I
landing?
No, I was in a small aircraft with Chip Piper with my parents when I was 5 years old.
Yeah.
And it crashed in Wyoming. What's so funny? This was very upsetting story to me. It was
he always
very
laughs
traumatic.
At plane crashes,
it was very traumatic. They couldn't find me for 5 days, and I was eventually found by Lamar Hunt, who was elk hunting in Wyoming.
Yeah.
And when he asked me, he saw me. I was in this edge of this cave, and I was only six. And he came over to me, and I was in shock. And it took them a long time to talk to me. And when he kept saying, "Where are you from? What's your name? How did you get here?" And the only words I could say was Meat Loaf.
Wow. That is a great what a fabulous story for you to share with us. And I'm glad the truth has finally come out. And I want to thank you. That's an incredible story. Just six?
Yeah, it was six. Between five and six.
Thing. Well, that's great. Well, now
I still have a scar on my knee from it.
That was where they landed.
No, no, that's I fell off out of the cave onto a rock. Well, I got that out of hell, I'll be gone.
When you became famous that quickly, did you go completely mad for a while? That was the impression I got from reading
about
you.
Yeah, not what the some paper said the other day, that I was drunk for 9 months. No, I mean, it was like, I don't like alcohol, and I like go someplace and order a bourbon and Coke, and everybody would go,
yeah,
what's he doing? It wasn't that I was drunk, but I was in that frame of mind, and I wasn't very rational, I don't think.
What was this then? This was other substances or just
no,
general
it's
fame?
No, it really wasn't any, it was fame. Then it was like, I didn't ever choose this profession to be famous, to be a star, for the money, for any of the above. I did it because I liked the work. Mm. That's what Meat Loaf is. Meat Loaf is about the work. I enjoy my work. It means a lot to me. It is what God put me on this earth to do, and the longer I do it, the more I understand that, and I get so much love. And like we said a while ago, I work. That's who I work for, but at the same time, it's an honor. Anything for love. Number one in I don't know how many countries, and number one for a long time, and that's an honor. That's a privilege not to be taken lightly. That's an awful lot of love that someone's giving you. And so I have to give it back. And the way I give it back is by giving everything I have at the show, coming and sitting and talking to you, because there's people out there that want to know things, mm-hmm. and do that, and by doing the best I can all the time. And so I'm going to return that love any way I can. And that's what this is about. And I forgot the question, but I got that in anyway.
But it sounded good all the way up to there, I tell you. Let me ask you a little bit about one other thing, which has got actually relates to nothing whatsoever.
Oh, I love relating.
So there's no link
nothing
here.
Relating.
Somewhere, I read somewhere.
The way I think.
I read somewhere that either you had put this idea forward or someone had suggested to you that you were the reincarnation of King Henry VIII of England.
Oh, it's not a notion. I am the reincarnation of Henry VIII.
Well, here we
it's
are, you
the
see.
The same as I am a sex god. I mean, it's not that. I am Jim Steinman was Anne Boleyn. Everybody knows that. It's in print. It was in Q magazine, I think.
But this is a great story. I think this is, I can see you. King Henry VIII, you need to get one of those big chicken legs and just carry it out on stage with you.
Oh, man, I'm telling you.
Pants with the big bows and all that stuff.
Yeah, well, see that. You know, I figured that part of my karma was that I should have a wife and two daughters and have to deal with them and have to live with it. You know, nobody got beheaded or anything like that. That I couldn't eat as much meat because he suffered from gout, you know. But, you know, Henry VIII was cool. He wrote Greensleeves.
He
played
good
guitar.
Life. Yeah, but then they sued him, and then he came, and it's 16 years later till he did Greensleeves too. Now, you just mentioned karma here, and I noticed on the sleeve notes, because I'm one of those sad people who do read sleeve notes. Tibet House. People might not have read it. On the album credits, you ask people to support Tibet House, an organization devoted to the unique culture of the Tibetan people.
Well, that's...
So are you a Buddhist?
No, I'm not a Buddhist, but they're not trying to, you know, the Chinese are basically systematically... exterminating the Tibetan people, and I think that's a shame. You know, I mean, they people want to save spotted owls and elephants and tigers and Siberian tigers and everything, and they fail to mention, hey, there's this whole race of people, you know, that are like, you know, hey, people are, you know, they're going to be non-existent. So, you know, well, that's basically what that is. And then two of my good friends run that place, and so. And I've just put it in. I mean, it's not, you know, if there was anything that I could say about, you know, support something that would help Bosnia and do the same thing. Yeah. I mean, I'm not a political activist because I feel that if you start talking about politics from another country or anything like that, you're speaking from a place of ignorance. Mm. Because unless you're sitting in the room, it's like everybody that talks about Michael Jackson and all the rumors that are going on about Michael Jackson, we're all coming, anybody, I'm included, I mean, I'm going to raise my hand and go, you know,
but me,
I'm coming from a place of ignorance because I'm not there in that room.
But me, let's be honest, it's fun to talk about, isn't it?
It may be fun, but politics are not necessarily
but Michael
fun,
Jackson, that's fun to talk about, isn't it?
It's fun. Well, it's just kind of weird. I like Michael. I've known Michael for a very long time.
I know you've got all day. I'm busy. I've got to go. Let me ask you one more question before we finish up here. It's the year is 1993. Can we arrange now to get together in the year 2009?
And then
we can
talk about... Oh, you've already figured it up with the 16 years.
We can talk about Bat 3.
Bat 3, yeah, no.
This will be... Because Bat 2 is back in the hell, so it's back out of hell again, I suppose.
Yeah, no. Well, that's like that guy. I keep putting this in. I did it this afternoon. I'm going to do it again. There's this guy in America wrote this article in Entertainment Weekly about sequels. And I will make the same comment I made earlier today. This fellow had the brains of a small cow. He went on about, well, soon there will be Fleetwood Mac Rumors 2 and Bruce Springsteen Born in the USA Again Today.
Reborn in the USA. Born Again in the USA.
That's right. So I said, boy, this guy really just wanted to hear himself right, didn't he?
That's it.
And because, you know, if you take a band like Steely Dan and they break up and they come back together, it's very simple. They call themselves Steely Dan, not a problem. If it's Fleetwood Mac and they break up and they come back together, they call themselves Fleetwood Mac. It's easy. Bruce Springsteen, he's going to write songs. He calls himself Bruce Springsteen. The only way we had to tell people the team was back together and working the same way we did was by calling it Bat Outta Hell 2, you little moron.
I don't have a problem with it at all.
The one thing that drives me crazier than anything...
Yes, sir.
Is when they spell my name as one word.
Is it not the one word, Meat Loaf?
Oh, Johathan. Now, Johathan, do you spell Johathan Ross as one word?
Yeah, but I was given mine by my parents. I didn't find it in the woods or whatever you claim you got your name. I mean,
no,
mine's a real name,
Lamar,
not some kind of silly thing.
I've been called that since I was 6 years old.
Your real name is Marvin All Day. We all know it.
No,
you can't
but it's not.
If it was Marvin...
You see, they got my birthday wrong. They have my name
What's your
wrong.
Real name, then?
Michael.
Michael.
Mm-hmm.
Well, you see... No, but you see, I've read quotes of you saying, yeah, I always hated Marvin. Now I know why. It wasn't even your name.
That's right. You got to understand, Johathan. You got to understand. See, I get real open and real honest with you, and I say all these really right-on things, but every once in a while I throw these little twists in there
Curveballs.
Just to keep it interesting.
Yeah. Okay.
If not, you got to be different than everybody else.
That's it. Well, Meat-Loaf, I want to say thank you very much.
There's no dash in there.
Well, Meat...
Then why would you call me, why would you call me Mr. Loaf when you first sit down? If it's not too
You are correct, sir. I must agree with you there.
Okay,
but Meat Loaf as the product, as the food byproduct or whatever it is.
But I'm not a food. I have nothing to do with food. I am a human being.
I am not a dish. I am a human being.
That's right.
Elephant Man once said.
That's right.
Meat Loaf.
Good, I'll remember that.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you for that quote.
Great to speak to you.
No,
enjoy it, and good luck with the everything.
Thank you very
whatever
much.
Whatever you want. Nothing of you hardly. You're a slip of a man. But back then, you were a big fella.
You're a silver-tongued devil,
it's
too.
It's true. You're nothing more than a gazelle sitting next to me here.
A gazelle.
But there was this big guy on stage,
see,
big
what,
sweaty guy.
Is that the fastest animal in the world, a gazelle?
That's one of them.
But what's the... Is the cheetah faster?
The fastest one is the meatloaf beast.